Eli. So, Eli, Mushomatsky is Victoria's 10th Youth Poet Laureate. She serves as Victoria's champion.
Thank you. Thank you.
They serve, I have to put it in. Okay. Eli will seek to inspire and engage local youth to share their stories through written and spoken word. In 2021, Eli completed a double major, two, in writing and English with honors at the University of Victoria. She comes from Vanderbilt. Thank you, it's even here. They grew up in Vanhoof on the traditional territory of the Saugus First Nations. I'm so sorry, I'm really embarrassing myself. At UVic, Eli acted as fiction editor for a literary journal, This Side of the West, as well as senior editor for her campus. It says her campus at UVic, it should be there, shouldn't it? Her campus at UVic. Eli has poetry published in The Warren and participated in the City of Victoria's 2021 Resilient Muse Reading Series. Sounds pretty good, doesn't it? So here is her words. Their words. Here is their words. In the past couple of years, poetry has helped me turn inward and explore my relationships to myself. Now, as Youth Poet Laureate, I'd like to use poetry to look outward. In a time of great climate anxiety, I'm interested in how art can help us reclaim our responsibility to nature rather than simply escape it. Wonderful. Okay, Eli, welcome, welcome.
Thank you for having me. Oh, I think we're good. Awesome. Thank you guys so much for having me tonight. I'm really excited to be here. And it's funny, I did used to work at Russell's. I worked here for 2.5 years. So coming full circle. And also the first poetry event I attended in Victoria was actually a Planet Earth poetry reading, I think back in 2018. So
wow.
Double full circle, I guess, for me. So that's really exciting. And I don't know how successful I've been in turning outward. I think a lot of this is still just about me. So to start, I thought it might be fun to read an older poem. I wrote this when I was 20 and heartbroken, and it's about heartbreak, but I did not connect the dots. I was like, this came from the void. Nothing to do with the present circumstances, as one does. So this is called, But If You Leave Me for Spain, Who Will Feed the Goldfish? Just so you know, I stole those daffodils, pulled them out by the roots, cut them up like the mint I chew. If I could spit them out, I wouldn't. After you left, the fence flaked away in tiny orange scales. They decorate the bluegrass singing. I always get lost because the sparrows eat the kernels of paint. You said I was the antithesis of finding yourself. If you just let me hold your hand, we could be three-legged. Why don't we wear matching shirts? If I could chew on you, I would find some other white indie rocker kid to play the drums at me. You said I live at the center of a snail shell. You said turn left 3 times. But what about the suburban hole? And that is my early poetry. All right, so this next poem is about my mother, who is chronically ill, and there was a point where we thought it might be cancer. It was not cancer, but medical stuff is very complicated, and so it's about that. So this is called Jellyfish. I have nothing to grieve. I'm a griefless child. My mother and I lie side by side in 2 beds, hills and ferries away, as the benign tumor floats between us in the dark, graceful and golden. Its kind face frightens no one. A jellyfish. Its tentacles snare in my mother's ribs. Doctors use words too imprecise to cut. They tell me something ails my mother. Perhaps it's that I have negative space in my body or head, just like her. My bed is full of surgeons who wait to knife me as I sleep. I dream their knocks at the door. But I turn on a light and the shadows no longer wave like sea froths against my wall. If I look through the microscope, things too small to be seen grow together in colorful clusters that paper my eyelids, at home in my body. If I look at tumors, they tangle in each other, afraid to let go. Thank you. up here with me. That was a mistake. Classic. This next poem.
Thank you.
Horse service. Thanks. So this next poem is called The Creation of Adam, based on the painting by Michelangelo. Sorry, I'm just going to very quickly. There we go. Thank you, Taylor. I've noticed that something that comes up in my poetry a lot is the idea of disconnection. So disconnection from nature, disconnection from other people, but specifically disconnection from our bodies. I think, you know, that's definitely been something I've struggled with a lot. So this is about that, loosely. So the creation of Adam. I think of myself in images, oranges split down the middle, pavement damp with rain. Spring fields are the same as being underwater and fill the hollow in my gut where a rib used to be. Sometimes I'm a row of nude bodies on different planes, reaching out to touch fingertips that never quite meet. Legs sprawl and flex. Pastels outline the arching back. Each one watches the next, God and Adam refracting. I carved out my rib to be rid of the decay, but it left behind a hole in my torso that grew. I get stuck in my throat. Everything below is static. All that's left, a violet infected with root rot. The church bathroom, its eerie yellow light. A ringing that may have been someone screaming at me. I stretch for the memory, but it's in the space between fingertips, drifting. Okay, and so this one is called Cracked, and I'm excited to read this because this is brand new. I started writing this, I think, on Monday, so you guys are basically my first audience, so hopefully it goes over well. And this is called Cracked. Oh, and also a little bit of context, because I love mushrooms. I know nothing about mushrooms. I'm very new to mushrooms, but I think they're really cool, the tiny bit that I've read, and something I learned recently is that mushrooms are strong enough to push through concrete, when they grow upwards. So someone who knows about mushrooms is probably going to correct me, but yeah, that's what this poem is about. So mushrooms uproot roads. They are an inheritable disease to escape. They pulse, push aside years of concrete, hungry for sunlight. I climb skyscrapers to leave them behind. Mother fears I will fall from this glass precipice. Silly. Even if I lose my grip, a stray plane or balcony catches me. The ground remains far below. Nothing hurts from this height. Mother lays on the couch while I lurk above in silence. A bird hits the window, drunk on rotting crabapple. The pavement buckles. To eat a mushroom would be gorgeous. Gorging myself on the earth, I would be laced into a mycelium network. Instead, I eat tar. It stops my throat against the fear in my belly. Mother is not here. She is high on her pain meds and forgets I broke her back. No, mother broke it on rock. It cracked. Her tailbone, to be specific, root split in two. She couldn't walk, bedridden again, so I walked for her. I left her behind. Even with this delicate crust of pavement, the mushrooms still erupt, an infection of spores until I'm lost in the white. First audience for that was really lovely of you. Okay, so this next poem is, I don't know how many of you are familiar with Edward Gorey.
Excellent.
I'm glad some of you are. So this is based on, he has this alphabet book called The Gashly Chromatines. Excellent. So there's a line in there, it's, I guess, for some context, it's an alphabet book of children dying in really horrible ways. It's very funny. I hesitate to say that. It's very funny. I'm so glad. N in this book is for Neville, who died of ennui, which I think is hilarious. During the pandemic, it became a little bit more relevant. So this is for Edward Gorey and is for Neville, who died of ennui. I dress up as remedy for my tedious youth. My therapist laughs at my floppy hats and adores my pearl string snoods. Success. She says I haven't a wink of trauma to repress, and I'm a great Hepburn imitation to boot. Except my hands don't always work. They get too large and drift away. A little quirk from childhood, I've learned to hide behind elaborately knotted ties and double-breasted French suits. And sometimes I lie to lovers that the cat drank the wine. to cover the feeling I get when I undress for the night. In the window, I see my unadorned face, smooth as an egg. It unmakes me, and I become Neville all over again. What is that? Great, okay, so this will be my last poem for the evening. And this is cheating a little bit because I have read this before for The City as Youth Poet Laureate. I don't know if any of you watched The City YouTube, because if you watch The City YouTube, you might have seen this poem, maybe a bit presumptuous of me, but you know, nevertheless, this is my poem, Every Avocado Meets a Husband, and it's a little bit more fun than the other ones. Okay. I am the patriarch. My nursery is neat and my daughters bloom. When Zinnia dares creep from her loamy bed, I clip her vines and I chop my sweet alyssum short. Alas, my avocado tree, my flighty child, spindles like a hag. 16 years since she hatched, yet no corset keeps her trunk from twisting. She bears me no fruit and she climbs for the greenhouse's gleaming glass ceiling. A husband, I say, a husband for my avocado tree. The gardener fetches him, and we build the happy couple a bower. Oh, bliss indeed, with roses twining up the sides. My eyes, my spies, these roses watch her wed for me. She wipes her husband tree. The indignity! The roses inform me of these avocado tree's flowers open to a matching set of stigmas, two wombs with no seeds. Enraged, I run to my books, and they claim that avocado trees come in A's and B's rather than in he's and she's. Nonsense. I dig her up by the roots. I am the patriarch. Words like dichotomy and erasure of binary will not disrespect me. Only to find tangles and knots, their lives bonded in the plot I built their bower in. I cannot stand, fell my child. So the two of them live in peace, a merrily sexless old pair, while I see you and Mary Zinnia off to the weeds.
Well done, Eli. I want to tell you that a mushroom came through the roadway where I live. This little mushroom right through the concrete, so it's true. Thank you. That was just wonderful and makes us hopeful for the future, does it not? Okay, so Michelle Poirier Brown.
Hold on, I get to introduce you.
So Michelle, as most of us know her, is an internationally published poet and performer living on the unceded Sayuse territory in Vernon, BC. She just moved there a few months ago and we're still grieving. She is a citizen of the Métis Nation and Cree. Her work has appeared in ARC, CV2, the Greensboro Review, Grain, Valium, no, it isn't Valium, it's Vallum. That's because I made so many mistakes today. And several anthologies. You might be sorry you read this. You might be sorry you read this. Reveals how breaking silences and reconciling identity can refine anger into something both useful and beautiful. A poetic memoir that looks unflinchingly at childhood trauma, it also tells a story of coming to terms with a hidden Indigenous identity when the poet discovered her Métis heritage at age 38. This debut collection prioritizes the poet's story through a journey of pain, belonging, hope, and resilience. Okay, that's the formal introduction. So the informal one is, I first met Michelle at, I think it was a Patrick Lane workshop, right? Or was it Lorna?
No, you first met me in Rona's living room for a tough workshop with Arlene Harding.
Right. But then I really met you at the workshop at Honeymoon Bay a number of years ago. And I fell in love with her silk silver hair that's a bit shorter now. And the way she would drape it over her shoulders. So those of you with short hair don't get to do this, but the long hair people kind of go, oh, like that is just beautiful. Being a short, curly-haired person, I was jealous, of course, and awed by her beauty. Then she read the poem that she had written there, which is in the book called Benefactors of the Genocide, and I was awed by her writing and her power. She and I had this marvelous deal. So she used to be a treaty negotiator. And so she can do decisions I can't. And so we have this deal that if I can't make a decision on something within half an hour, I can call her and she will help me make the decisions. It's so cool. And she does. Okay, so, and she was the first poet, Planet Earth Poetry Reading Series Society. How's that? Planet Earth Poetry Reading Series Society. She was the first president and helped us really organize and get things together. She's very good at that. And she's very good at writing. And this book will attest that. You will definitely not be sorry you read it or bought it. In fact, you'll be grateful. So here's one review from Betsy Warland. This is a stunning debut, revealing how breaking silences and reconciling identity can refine anger into something both useful and beautiful. A poetic memoir that looks unflinchingly at childhood drama, and it tells the story of coming to terms with her Métis heritage. In her 5-decade story, perceptions, denial, emotional embroilments, and poignant tenderness are peeled back and examined. As the narrative builds, we encounter the sheer alchemical power of poetry. Michelle.
Okay.
Oh, I too forgot my water bottle.
Oh,
is that a good height? I don't know. I kind of wander around a bit when I'm reading, and
that'll be good.
And should we announce a a question and answer if you want at the end?
Sure. I'm going to. No, you've taken my phone here. We're close, honey, but we don't share a phone. Yeah, so I've been told I can read till 9, and I'm actually going to try and stop at 8:55 in case there are questions. Because we did a Q&A on Gabriel Island a couple of weeks ago, and that was kind of fun. It was a not bad idea. No, I actually do need these in these light. So it's a book of poetry. It's got a little bit of prose in it, and it is a memoir. So we're going to start in my childhood. God was a baby. It was Christmas Eve. The Christmas Eve astronauts read from Genesis as they circled the moon, and the world was agape. Their eyes upward, everything exactly as it was yesterday, but the axis of knowledge tilted. We walked in the street, the star-sprinkled, hard-packed tracks no less sparkled than the fresh drifts brimming the sidewalks. I slid my boots along the wide ridges, imagined pirouettes, blades parting the slick surface, my pleated plaid skirt a shimmering sheath beneath scarf and mitten stuffed coat. God was a baby. A marvel circled the moon, the world made of diamonds. And for those of you who have copies, we're going to hop forward to page 29. There's not a lot of form poems in the book, but there are a couple, and this particular form is called an anaphora, and it's called Walk on the Left-Hand Side. Because you want to see what is coming at you, because the ditch on that side is dry, because the neighbors will think better of you, because that's where you stashed the answers, because you see better out of your right eye, because you never know, because you want to be well lit, because you're hoping to pass as somebody else, because of the dog who growls at you through the fence, because the sun shines warmer there, because you're hoping he'll see you, because of the bookstore window, because of the wind, because lilacs are in bloom, because it's in the direction. Because that was the side you walked on then. And then we're over on page 30. Now, I haven't put any of the trauma poems in this reading. I like to say this is a funny book about childhood trauma. But I have written this poem about what it's like to live traumatized. But this poem has struck a chord with so many people that maybe were either all traumatized or it just seems to ring a bell in that way. It's called 5:53 p.m. Shouldn't have begun, shouldn't have ended. We'll never be the same. We'll never come back. We'll never matter to anyone but me. Shouldn't have shouted, shouldn't have named it. That time I took and didn't pay, knew I couldn't pay enough. Shouldn't have called. Calling was the only thing to do. Shouldn't have answered. The moment the letter dropped through the slot, I knew. Shouldn't have bought it. Shouldn't have accepted that moment. Then shouldn't. Regrets. Shouldn't have sent roses. Shouldn't have stayed home. Shouldn't have gone. The moment of agreeing. The moment passed. Rest. Shouldn't have expected. Gone on. Trusted. Opened. Doubted. Laughed. Knew the moment had passed. The moment I knew it would rain. Knew I shouldn't have spoken. Shouldn't have been late. Shouldn't have waited. The moment I knew the water was deep. So we're going to bounce a few pages forward to page 34. And this is a poem in parts. Lorna Crozier got us writing poems in parts. I've never been the same. I love a poem in parts. This particular poem has 5 parts. But have no fear, some of them are quite short. In fact, one of them is a tercet with only 3 syllables per line. The theme of this poem and its title lasts. After 26 years of psychotherapy, this was as good as I'd get. I intended it to be my last marriage. People talk of lists, and I suppose my true criteria comprised a list, but I did keep it to 2. I would be loved. He would have his own money. The last croom cucka, the last notch in the belt, the last of the tampons, the last tailored shirt, the last Ativan, the last thing I said to my mother. The last time I had sex for money. Halfway down the stairs, it stopped me. I need to see my father. I borrowed my lover's car, drove the 6 hours from Regina to Selkirk, parked outside the tackle shop. He was out, making the round of fishing spots, flies, wrigglers, sodas, chips. He saw the plate in the lot, came through the door, swinging his face to find me. My father passed the following weekend from a heart attack. It's going to take us a moment just to say hello. There they are, the Zoom people. Thank you for coming. Oh, John. Hi, I'm Terry. Marianna. There's more of them. I can't see them all. Take a look at that later. Thank you. Okay, we're on page 38 now. And so I lost my job to nasty side effects from psychoactive drugs. And when I was recovering, I spent a number of months listening to the Neapolitan novels, those 4 novels by Elena Ferrante, or as we know, the author Elena Ferrante, that start with My Beautiful Friend. And I listened to them probably, well, at least 3, possibly 4 times, often at night, you know, that little voice in your ear. So this is a poem that has secrets. Some of them are from the characters in the book. Some of them are mine. And you need to read the books to be able to know the difference. This is called Intimacy after listening to Elena Ferrante in translation. She whispers to me about the time she pulled a knife in the schoolyard, the man she slept with to have his friends, the tip she stole from the next table. Who would tell you these things to your face? Would I tell you, I want to catch your necklace, trace my finger from your clavicle to your breast, feel the chain hurt you just the way I want it to? Who would admit not loving a child, infections, what you've done for money or a ride? These words on the page slice a line that beads with blood. Lick here. So halfway through the book, there's just a page that says about face, and the next poems are on the other side of that. I'm going to start with a poem that was written in response to Prism International said that they were doing a call for poems on the theme dreams. And this was actually, I think, it's quite possibly the very first of my poems to get published. So I'm quite fond of it. It's called Wake. You dream me still, racialized, deracialized, decolonized. You ask if I have or use a pre-colonial mind. You suggest edits to my biography, tell me my stated identity doesn't exist and that you know this because you are getting a PhD in Indigenous Lit. You ask me flat out if I'm queer, if you can tick off another box on the grant application. You dream we are friends and I become someone you say you get to. You dream we are friends and I become someone you get to say you met for tea in the village. You dream we are friends and you tell me you've taken oranges to the tent city because, of course, that is something I would want to know. In your dreams, I am often too much, more often not enough. Because of your dreams, you find me repellent, take a prurient interest in my childhood. Your dreams make it hard for me to wake up. I dream I am drowning. I have this dream while I'm awake. I remember the time we met on the phone, your rude awakening when I showed up at your door. I was still asleep. I checked my shoes to make sure they were clean, as if that had to be the problem. There was the year you told me it would be best if I chose a different week to rent a cabin, that my daughters were two children, too many. You stood beside me on the riverbank as I watched the children flunked by in inner tubes, one of mine vibrant with excitement, the other grinning with fear. I think you dreamed I'd never tell. The grief from that one dreamed me for a long while. The past is a dream that streams around me, my voice rising through it like bubbles, void of vibration, their only sound, an almost inaudible pop when they reach the surface. What you cannot see of me fills my lungs. Always I am waking. I turn up in strange clothes, new words in my mouth, people I no longer know smile as if I remember. I look for others also awake, mostly go home alone. Always I am swimming, cold and asleep, upstream, bear dips a paw into the stream, flips me breathless against the sky. Wake, he says, wake.
going to go to page 54, and I wasn't going to read this one. I was going to read 55, but I think I'll read them both. I really want to read. I only want to read this one. This one's dedicated to Eli. A fragile defiance. You need only be the simple expression of the divine intent that is your life, your breath, an act of insubordination. To continue breathing is political. Give voice, seditious. Be beautiful, subversive. Every aesthetic has its rules, its strategy, power. Your presence, the message. Think twice. So I'm going to bounce forward now to page 69. This is another form poem, in this case, a villanelle. It's an important person in my life who's recovering from alcoholism, and this poem is from very early on in that process. It's called Slow. I am not required to travel fast, much as desire might draw. What happened then is still not past. I don't know the role I'm cast, the shape and nature of my flaw. I am not required to travel fast. I answer, even come when asked, wait for the cold to thaw. What happened then is still not past. My spirit bruised, my heart harassed, the long rub spot still raw. I am not required to travel fast. If it's true, you've drunk your last, set right a year's long yaw. What happened then is still not past. I could, with time I will perhaps spin beauty out of straw. For now, I will not travel fast. What happened then is still not past. And this is the last poem in this prepared set. There are two grandmothers in this poem. One, I speak about from time to time throughout the manuscript, my Métis grandmother, who she spoke both French and English, but was married to someone who spoke only French. And my other grandmother, whose first language was Ukrainian. And given what's gone on in Eastern Europe, I'm very glad that this poem got written and got included in the manuscript. It's called The Other Grandmother. There were times I would sense the contours of my face. Perhaps I was tired, perhaps relaxed. Would try to hold my features perfectly still, walk gently to a mirror to catch a glimpse of what I looked like in that state. Check if with that expression, I looked like my grandmother. Her long face, her flamboyant indifference, her mannishness, her brazen disregard for good taste in mixed company. Check. Was I ugly? There were times I tried to memorize the feeling of enough of a smile to lift the sag of my cheek, dull line of my mouth, brighten my brow with an arch. Try to recreate the image I would sometimes see walking alongside the glass wall of the bank or coming out of a toilet stall, a woman I didn't recognize, breathtakingly thin in a navy port suit. She'd show up in photos, the bull rush on the arm of a chair, white turtleneck, cable knit sheath, an arc of laughter. Who was she? Then yesterday, seated across from a mirror, a happenstance, long look. The stranger surfaced, stayed. We had come to terms, my face and I. The grandmother I no longer sculpted away. And this one.
Thank you, Michelle. So we have a few minutes. If you have any questions, throw them out this way.
Anything you want to ask? Some of you know me well, and so I thought I'd save a few minutes at the end just in case anyone wanted to ask about the writing of the book or the journey to get here.
How long have you been together? I know you've been working on lots of things in the past years that I've known, but I recognize a lot of them. So how long does it sort of be?
Well, the coming together caught me by surprise, because what I did is I went through and pulled out every poem that I had written over the years that I thought was had any hope of being worth being included in a manuscript. And of course, most of them were from the more recent years. Once I connected with Planet Earth poetry, the learning opportunities that come through these folks are frequent and amazing. So most of the production has been in the last few years, but there are poems in the manuscript that date back even to the early 80s when I first moved to Victoria. And I sent the manuscript, and for poets, this probably is an interesting little bit. I sent the manuscript, I organized it into clumps of, okay, these poems are about this and these poems are about that. And went to the Sage Manuscript Intensive, Sage Hill Manuscript Intensive that they have every summer, and said, okay, so what more do I need to write in order for this to be a book? And Sandra Ridley said, oh, honey, you've got more than a book here. And so that was in the summer. By the fall, I'd reorganized the manuscript so that they were in chronological order and pulled out about a third of them. And the first deadline that was coming up for manuscripts was the Robert Croach competition. And so by January, I had a publisher. It was stunningly and surprisingly fast. And then it was another year for the book to come out. Yeah.
So you have a third of a manuscript waiting for the next book.
Well, I have a chapbook coming out in the fall called Intimacies, which is going to be poems and photographs. And Sandy, you and I need to talk. It's time to do that photo exhibit.
That's going to be great.
So I have a question.
Yes.
So in your book is at the back is a poetic statement, which is an unusual thing in a poetry book. And I was really quite delighted with that. And I think, what was it? One of the things you said, when I cannot speak for tears, when I cannot be heard for rage, a poem speaks for me. You want to talk a little bit more about your poetic statement?
Sure. I think that line's actually from the interview. There's an interview on, I'm doing a reading at Massey Books on June the 2nd, and they very sweetly published an interview with me asking about that. And so, yeah, sometimes a poem speaks for me. I don't know if other poets, there's probably several poets in the room that can deeply relate to this, that you really have no idea what you're writing about until you get to the mark at the end of the poem and you go, yeah, I think that's it. And then you go back and read it and you go, oh, this poem, yes. And this poem speaks for me. And one of the things I've learned about writing trauma poems is that it's actually the parts that you don't say. There are the silences in poetry that can really speak volumes. And I've learned that more from sharing the poems afterwards and talking with other folks. And we find that it's those unsaid things that are perhaps the loudest thing on the page. Yeah.
I have a question. The title, did you go through some other titles first, or how did you end up with this stunningly exciting title?
Well, remember when I told you the poems were clumped in sections, and so I put all the childhood trauma poems in one pile, and we had come up with little names for the piles. And the pile that was all trauma poems, I said, well, we could tell people, you might be sorry you read these, and have a laugh about that. And then the editor I was working with at the time, Chelsea Como, who's a poet many of you know, she said, oh yeah, well, that's funny, but hang on to that. You might want to keep that. And so then when we reorganized the manuscript into chronological order, I pulled that out of the waste bin and put it at the top of the manuscript. Yeah. And it's, you know, there are things in the book that my family's really pissed with me. Yes, Kate.
What do you write with? Like, do you write with pencil or pen, or do you write on your laptop, or what's your
desktop? Because of my arthritis, I would really like to write with a pen or a pencil. That's because you can do that anywhere. I've, you know, written so many poems that I have later found in the glove box of the car. But these days, because of arthritis, my hands are these useless objects on the ends of my arms. And so I type because it's so much easier. And you get used to it. You can write. Okay. Good. It's 9:00. I'm going to let you go. Catch your buses.